Good afternoon to all our participants. Welcome to the 9th Shichankar Virtual Seminar Initiative on Artificial Intelligence, organized by the Center for Bhutan Studies in cooperation with the International Society for Bhutan Studies. This series explores how applications of AI, digital, and deep learning technologies can improve governance and well-being. In this particular session, we will discuss how AI and drone technology can be utilized for environmental conservation efforts. Africa is a negative country with a constitutional mandate.
You are mute.
Yazin, I think you need
to unmute. It was a little technical difficulty. So we are delighted, I'm just going to continue. We are delighted to create a platform for debate and discourse on the exploration of different approaches and methods to incorporating AI into good governance. Despite being a negative emissions least developed country, Bhutan continues to restrain its socioeconomic development to maintain more than 71% of its geographical area under forest cover. And currently, more than 50% of the total land area is formally under protected areas, biological quarters, and natural reserves. The devastating impact that climate change is having on Bhutan's economy and our vulnerable communities and biosphere are key challenges that the Royal Government of Bhutan is committed to addressing as stated in its 12th five-year plan. Our session today is an exciting interaction between two very interesting environmental stewards, one who is a pioneering academic researcher and another who is an on-ground practitioner. In this context, we are delighted to welcome our moderator for today, Mr. Sona Mongdi, as he's intimately involved in Bhutan's environmental conservation efforts. Mr. Sona Mongdi currently works as a chief of the Nature Conservation Division under the Department of Forests and Park Services of the Royal Government of Bhutan. As the chief of this division, he oversees the overall conservation programs in Bhutan, both within and outside of its protected areas. He is responsible for technically advising the protected area system of Bhutan, which includes 5 national parks, 4 wildlife sanctuaries, a strict nature reserve, and our designated network of biological corridors that interconnect these areas. Mr. Mongdi is a key actor when it comes to giving policy guidance on conservation and the protection of Bhutan's biodiversity and environment. He also serves as a program director for the Bhutan for Life project, a $43 million innovative financing program for sustainable conservation of protected areas for a period of 14 years, which was initiated in the year 2018. So it's very exciting to have you here, Mr. Sona Mongdi. Thus, it is with great pleasure for the CBS team and our esteemed audience to welcome Mr. Mongdi. The floor is yours, La.
Thank you, Yazin. Thank you for the wonderful introduction about myself. Thank you very much. Honorable President, Center for Bhutan and GNH Studies, Dashukar Mawura, Dr. Yves Lamounier, keynote speaker for today's session, distinguished viewers from around the world, ladies and gentlemen, a very good afternoon to everyone. Welcome to the 9th Shichankar Virtual Seminar Initiative on Artificial Intelligence, organized by the Center for Bhutan and GNH Studies. This series explores how the application of artificial intelligence, digital and deep learning can improve governance and well-being. In this particular session, we will discuss how artificial intelligence and the emerging technologies of UAVs or drones can supplement our environmental conservation efforts. Bhutan, the only country in the world to have a constitutional mandate of ensuring 60% forest cover for perpetuity, has been ushered into the 21st century with much of its environment pristine and intact. And we continue to carry forward this legacy of our far-sighted visionary monarchs, guided by wise policies and practical legal frameworks, which is further supported by political willingness of the governments. It is for this reason we are looked upon as a champion and a leader in environmental conservation. With more than half of our country under a well-connected protected area system and with more than 70% of our country under forest cover, Bhutan remains as one of the only two carbon negative countries in the world. However, with changing times and needs of our younger generation and of our future generations, we cannot afford to remain complacent, basking in our past glories and continue with business as usual. We have to evolve with changing times to face the emerging conservation challenges. It is only apt that we start embracing efficient technologies of time and bring relevance to what we do daily. The field of environmental conservation in Bhutan, or for that matter, anywhere around the world, has always embraced technologies for the purpose of supporting and easing researches and management. Starting from GPS devices to camera traps to the use of smart for recording or patrolling and monitoring visits, we, the environmental conservationists of Bhutan, have managed to stay abreast with the advancement of technologies. UAVs or drones, as the latest in the line of technological advancement for use in our field of work, has also been added recently to the field of conservation researches and monitoring in Bhutan. But I, in the capacity of one of the drone operators in my own department, feel that we have been able to touch just the tip of the iceberg in terms of what this technology is really capable of, and feel very much privileged to introduce and moderate this very relevant session that seeks to discuss new approaches and strategies to incorporate artificial intelligence and drone technology in helping us conserve our pristine and sacred environment. It is for this very reason I'm very excited to welcome our keynote speaker, Dr. Yves Lamounier, who is a senior scientist at the Center for International Forestry Research, C4, based in Bogor, Indonesia. Dr. Lamounier has over four decades of experience in tropical ecology, vegetation science, ethnobiology, remote sensing and land use planning, drone ecology, including participatory approaches to landscape management. He is also a senior scientist at the French Agriculture Research Center for International Development and also an associate professor at the University of Toulouse. With his years of professional experience leading multidisciplinary researches on collaborative land use planning and ecosystem services incorporating the use of drones, we are indeed very fortunate and grateful to Dr. Lamounier for taking time out of his busy schedule for this seminar, despite his very busy schedule, and are delighted to welcome him to share his ideas and strategies with us. Dr. Lamounier, we are all yours now. Thank you.
Well, thank you very much, Sonam, for this introduction. And let me say hello to good afternoon to everybody, and maybe good morning for colleagues in UK. I am very happy to be here today. And we'll try to share my experience, of course, mainly in Indonesia, because almost all my life I work in Indonesia. So without waiting further, I will share my screen for this presentation. Do you see my screen? Yep.
Yes, yes, Dr. Lamounier, please go ahead.
Okay, so, sorry. So today, as it was mentioned, we are going to talk about the role of artificial intelligence and drone technology in environmental conservation. It will be more about drone than artificial intelligence itself. We are using also remote sensing, machine learning, and this kind of things. But today I'm going to discuss more the aspects of drone technology. It's a presentation that I prepare with my Indonesian colleague, Uji Pribadi, at C4 in Bogor, in Indonesia. So actually a bit about the background. Yeah. Actually, why I come to this drone mapping exercise It's because at the origin, it's part of a rather big project about participatory development approach for empowering local stakeholders in natural resource management in Indonesia. And so that's our work now is part of a larger program on developing a kind of participatory methodology for landscape management. The general idea is to develop models, to co-develop models for decision making in spatial planning, land zoning, and community-based natural resource management. Very briefly, in Indonesia, as in many other countries, actually, spatial planning and land allocation get many issues. Mostly the lack of coordination within sectors and overlapping authorities. So it makes decisions sometimes very difficult to reach. The land use policies are driven honestly by large scale business very often and political agenda. It's a rather top down process and community are not rather not really involved or maybe not enough involved. There is a lot of tenurial conflicts between state-owned versus customary land. For instance, it's still common to find this kind of conflict. But also, in terms of land use planning, small-scale mapping, where you need really detailed data for land zoning allocation, it's really missing. Just an example. So Indonesia is a very huge country, of course, and this land allocation for to distribute the use of the land is still made at a scale of 1 to 250,000. Here it's one district where we work a lot in Indonesia, where you have two national parks in Borneo, in the island of Borneo. And that's very, very crude data. When you want to work at the local level with community or with local government, this scale is not good enough, yeah, to make decision in the field. So it means we need a larger scale mapping and data, spatial data, to discuss. To discuss local local management of the landscape, and especially at village level. So again, yeah, this kind of data insufficiently detailed, and they have also serious inaccuracy that are very often a big problem, and even it's based on the national. Small-scale scoring, which is good for the national level of Indonesia, but again, it's not sufficient at local level. So, of course, when we do landscape management, I hear some kind of
echo. It's called phenomena.
So,
it's called phenomena.
When we do this, when we do this land use planning issue work, of course, like everybody, we use since a long time, we use satellite data, satellite remote sensing to map large area. Of course, that's still the best and only way. But we still have a lot of issue when you do satellite, when you want to use satellite data, especially in Indonesia. That's Indonesia is crossed by the equator and you have a lot of cloud cover almost every time. So the cloud free coverage is actually very rare. For instance, we get only two good images for central Kalimantan, the central part of Borneo in 2020. It's not really adequate in that case also for spatial and temporal resolution, because if you want to study phenomena in time, you will have this issue of repeatability. Again, because of cloud cover, maybe you don't get good image, good data from every year. And also with satellite data, very often it did not represent the phenological stage of the vegetation. Why? Again, it's because of cloud cover. So we are looking for satellite image which are free of, more or less free of cloud cover, which means it will be during the dry season. So again, we have an idea of the phenology during the dry season, but not during the wet season. So also there is this issue in the satellite environment that either you get free data, but rather low resolution, like let's say Landsat satellite, or you get, if you want to work more in detail, you have also high resolution data that are sometimes very good, but they are also very expensive. And also in terms of, you will say, okay, cloud cover, maybe radar technology can be used. That's true, it can be used sometimes, but my own experience, it has been more or less useful in lowlands, flat area, swamp area. It has been quite useful. But as soon as you enter hilly terrains, mountains, it's very difficult to interpret vegetation with radar data. Why does it move here? Okay, I don't know why it was not moving. So looking at this issue about the satellite data and that the fact that we want to get more detailed information and more detailed spatial data to work with at local level with local government, local villages, we wanted to explore this feasibility of using the small drone technology for the acquisition of large-scale data, geospatial data, to get also more bottom-up kind of collaborative spatial planning and land management. So, of course, you know about drones, and there are so many different drones from these little birds at the very left top, from bigger drones that use looks like a helicopter or looks like a plane. And it's some of them quite big. Actually, as you know, this come first from the military research and development. So you have also mixed appreciation from the general public about drones. Many are concerned about the safety, the security, the privacy, and the regulation, of course. It has been very often, it's perceived as just a surveillance equipment, and their use has been sometimes criticized by individuals, also NGOs. But at the same time, we cannot not realize that it is more and more used by so many companies for transporting, surveying, inspecting, and imaging, and their technological development is very often driven by active community of hobbyists and enthusiasts. Yeah? You have more and more young people using drone for photography, and you have a lot of small NGOs using drone for various purposes and so on. So there is this enthusiasm also nobody can deny. And that's why many countries now have to face this new technology, and it's kind of changing a lot of the rules. Many countries have legitimized by regulation, not all of them. So sometimes it's a bit difficult to bring a drone in some countries. The regulation is another important issue. So when we very quickly, when we speak about drone, you have seen also that you are faced basically with two models, kind of small helicopter, multi-rotor kind of machine, and the other type is something that looks more like a small plane, a fixed wing drone. So both of them have advantage and inconvenience. The multi-rotor, the copter drone are usually more maneuverable. Also, they are often cheaper, they are more portable. They are also, for beginners, they are much easier to use. But to compare with the fixed wing, their range is a bit less. And also, they are maybe less stable, especially if you have an issue with the engine. The fixed wing, of course, which looks like a small plane, it will be easier to bring it back to the ground. It can be an issue with a copter. In terms of payload capacity, the big copter can be very, very good, but actually here I put fixed wing a bit less payload, but it was our experience some years ago, and I think now there is a lot of improvement with new fixed wing coming. And of course, in terms of mapping, the fixed wing can cover a larger area. I think it's a big advantage when you want to do mapping. But if it's just participatory mapping, let's say with one village, usually the multi-rotor, the copter is enough. Also, you should be aware that you have now more and more do-it-yourself to save cost of drones. So, here at the right, you have conservation drones. They are colleagues from Malaysia, and they are developing their own drone, which become better and better. And here in Indonesia, at the beginning, it was the same for us. We work with a small NGO in the West Kalimantan province of Indonesia. And they are enthusiast, hobbyist people, usually working with radio controllers, this kind of thing for modeling. And these people can easily find cheaper way of building drones. So actually, I think with something between 1,500 and 2,000 US, you can have already, including the camera, you can have already a very good sufficiently efficient drone to bring to the field. Again, back to satellite versus drone, without going too much into detail, but again, it's a matter of pixel resolution, of course, with the drone having pixel resolution, of course, depending on at which elevation you fly, but it's usually between 10 and 20 centimeters, for instance. The repeatability over time is a great advantage of the drone because it is not hampered by the cloud cover. But of course, in terms of coverage, satellite data can cover much bigger area than the drone. In terms of cost, the drone is also much cheaper, but again, covering less big area. In terms of sensor, at the beginning, of course, satellites were in advance, but now with new technology and you can get more smaller sensor equipment, you can actually have also multispectral thermal mini LiDAR on a drone. So, and finally, of course, the drone is usually easy to transport. Just a few illustrations again. If you see that, again, it's in Borneo. And you can see on the bottom of this of the screen that's the Landsat data for the same area. On the top, you see the drone. So of course, you can see the enormous difference in terms of spatial special resolution and the level of details that you can obtain. So for instance, on the Landsat image, I don't know if you see my cursor, but what you see in red here is his burn scar after people burn the field to do crops, to plant rice. So you see on the Landsat, you can still see the burn scar. Of course, there are a bit more detail in the drone, but you see also that you have this issue of in white, you see the cloud, you have the shadow of the cloud, and even on the very left, you have a piece of forest identified by Landsat, but if you see on drone, it's much, much more detailed. And so this level of detail that you obtain from drone is absolutely fantastic to do detail mapping. Other applications, of course, which are more and more used and famous for drone is the photogrammetry in cartography, mapping, photogrammetry, monitoring of plantation, coastline, surveillance of plantation. It's also used for monitoring floods. It has been used in Indonesia during large floods to monitor pollution also. In urban planning, because you can do 3D modeling of the buildings. It has been used in archaeology. It's also very good to do digital elevation model. It's, you have a lot of software that can help you to do that. And of course, it's used to do orthophoto. That's the one we use the most to study the vegetation. And maybe for our conservation issue today, I mean the thematic of today about conservation, of course, drone application in wildlife study is according to me really fantastic, and it's going better and better. So, of course, again, vegetation mapping for me, I am a vegetation ecologist at the beginning, so vegetation for me is really something absolutely necessary to study first when we arrive in a new landscape. And for this, drone is really, really fantastic. So we can use it also for ground truthing for satellite data calibration. So if you want to calibrate some of the satellite data using the drone, it's also something that we did, and it's very, very useful. You can also look at the pattern change detection while changing scale of observation. So it's like when you use, especially with a copter drone, so you can have some pictures of your location at 100 meter elevation, above 100 meter elevation, 400, 1 kilometer. And so you can study in one spot, you can study something important in ecology, the change of scale, to discuss, to assess the ecological variable, something like that. Yeah, that's very useful for ecological study. Change detection over time, again, because of this almost never bothered by the cloud cover. So it means you can really, I will give a short example later, you can really look at change detection over time and landscape dynamics. And of course, you can, even if you look at more detailed study of ecological study of the, let's say, the canopy of the forest, you can also try to estimate forest or vegetation structure, especially with a tool that we call the structure from motion photogrammetry that allow you to really look at the structure of the vegetation. You can try also to do species recognition to help also in canopy ecology and ecosystem functioning. And of course, you can do also animal observation. More and more people are doing this because you can use video and photography, of course. You can look at animal search like infrared camera, for instance, in Indonesia, many people have tried to monitor orangutan population, for instance, with infrared camera, and it's working quite well. at least you can also identify the canopy nest of the orangutan, for instance. So I think in the future you will have, I know people working on other monkeys species and these kind of things. And I think in the future it will be more and more used. And of course, the big one is also about forest, but especially agriculture health monitoring. So you can, you have more and more people using drones to monitor the pest, the damage caused by pest. You have also, you can also monitor the disease and infestation detection again with infrared camera. So that's a lot of potential use by these drones. So now I will come back to our own experience in Borneo, in Indonesia, for this particular case where we wanted to monitor together with the local communities to monitor the landscape. So you see this kind of landscape in that part of Indonesia. It's also the results of Sweden agriculture. Sweden agriculture in Indonesia, that's really still practiced in almost all the islands of Indonesia. It's covered like 11 million hectares and it represents like 6 million people. So that's really still nowadays, Sweden agriculture is a very important component of the landscape dynamic. You can see here, so it's kind of in that area, it's a kind of hilly terrain with some remnant forest, with some regrowth after crops, so secondary fallow, these kind of things. Here in the valley, you have a rice field, but usually they grow rice on the slopes, not irrigated rice. So basically, in terms of method, typical of what we'll do to this kind of intervention with the community. So following several village meetings to explain our objective and methodology of this mapping project, we managed to get free prior and informed consent, of course, that was provided under the village assembly. And after this initial scoping survey and understanding of local perception, we will work, we will go to the field together with the farmers to get more information about their ecological traditional knowledge to get together kind of co-knowledge sharing. And when it's better understood from both parties, we will start to flying missions. Always organize also with community members that always accompany us in the field. So in this particular case, we use fixed wing. This model is called a Skywalker. It's equipped with just normal camera. And of course there is a radio telemetry system and a laptop in the field just to monitor the flight. We fly at 400 meter elevation, just after the burning season, because we want to monitor also this burning scar in the landscape. And more or less for a total of 3,000 hectare maps, we will use 3 to 4 days depending on the weather. And we have repeated this for 3 years. I apologize if I short a bit, because here in Bogor, in Jakarta, it's a kind of big storm now, and the rain is very, very heavy. So I hope you still hear me. So after we finish the flying mission, we get the first draft of what we call orthophoto mosaic, which is presented to the community for verification, of course, and we go together again with the community for a participatory ground check. And at the same time, we do together with them also, we do a vegetation sampling of the unit that we identified first on this orthophoto mosaic. So this map is presented to the all the village community, of course, but also to the neighborhood village, to the village who are living in the border of this landscape, to make sure that we don't create conflict between village. So everybody, including the other village, are informed about these results. And at the same time, so this is the photo mosaic, the orthophoto mosaic that we share with everybody. And while we present this to a neighboring village and the main people of the village, we go together to do this sampling of the vegetation, and we follow the local classification. So here you see from the what we call Humai, which is the beginning of the planting of the rice after after burning the field. Damun is the fellow, so you have the young fellow, Damun Muda, and the old fellow, Damun Tua. And then you have the old secondary forest, Pengrang, and Utan Utan is the forest. At the same time, you have different land use from the rice that they cultivate in the swamp to some rubber plantation suggested by the government. But we have also this mixed forest garden, which are very rich in fruit trees and completely locally managed. And it's a kind of traditional way of cultivation for these people. And you have also what we call, what they call Pulao. It's a kind of sacred forest area where nobody is entitled to cut any trees. So this all together give us some knowledge of this area. And at the end, we get what I can say, the high quality at scale community control map. So you can see that this map is quite quite detailed. And we have up to 25 vegetation class from the forest. We can identify some part that has been logged over by a company. We have all the secondary forest class from this traditional reserved forest, or this kind of old mixed garden that correspond to a former village area. We can differentiate very well the secondary regrowth, the fellows, either young or older. And we have also some area with shrubs, grassland, newly open area, burn scar, upland paddy field. We have also very detailed information about the place for mixed garden, banana field, other with rubber garden. And we can have even indication about the age of the rubber garden, the traditional rubber garden that we can also differentiate from the more like newly introduced smallholder rubber plantation by the government. And also we can also differentiate swamp forest, for instance. So we have this high quality very different from the sketch map that we were doing in the past with the community, with that it was not at scale. It was a very kind of data that it was difficult to convince government to appreciate. But now with this map at scale, completely at scale, and also made by the local community together with us, both local government and also companies that want to invest in this landscape. They are, it means the community can negotiate much properly with this potential investor in the field. And another example also that we will not be able to do with the satellite, because in that area it's full of cloud cover almost all the time. So with a drone, we can, by repeating this flying mission every year, we can monitor the landscape dynamics. So we can see exactly from year to year what area was burned for the Sweden agriculture. And you know, this Sweden farmer, very often they are blamed for destroying the forest. Actually, you can see here that that's not the case. So the area of Sweden agriculture from this 3 years period increased only only by 2% on the forest. Most of the time, 80% of Sweden fields, they come, the burning area, the transformation, come from the grassland, fern, savanna, or the young fallow. So it means people are not really using the forest to do agriculture, but they are more using the secondary regrowth of the forest. At the same time, we see that the proportion of a very short burning cycle means a place that is burned almost every year during 3 years was about 50%. So in that case, it's revealed also that in that particular area, Sweden cycle are shortened. In the past, it used to be like 10 years, sometimes 15 years before they go to open the field. Now, in that particular area, it can be almost every year that they are going to burn. In that case, it's also an issue, because if there is no time for the regeneration of the soil after, maybe there is some loss of soil fertility. So in terms of strengths for this experience that we have, I think it's first, I'm convinced, I saw that the participatory mapping with this drone technology were quite attractive to communities. Everybody was very curious, interested, and they enjoy the exercise. We don't have any people. Okay, that's area where we used to work a long time, so we know very well the village, but still people were not against this exercise, and they were happy to see the results. At the same time, the neighboring village, after looking at that, will come to us to ask for the same kind of thing, for the same kind of mapping. It was quite high cost effective. And also we can observe a kind of possible social reinforcement of communities because of this cohesion of working together, discussing again about the landscape, but with proper document, with really at scale detail. And these people, they can really read map. Some people were questioning this issue, but actually, because these people are so familiar with the landscape and especially the river, they can very easily spot any location on the map. So it was also a lot of good social reinforcement of communities around the map. And I think the most obvious strength is this control of data acquisition and ownership by communities. So it allows them to really discuss properly with local government and local investors sometimes that, for instance, want to open this land for all palm plantation or something. Now they have really a kind of document that can be legalized, much stronger than the former sketch map that they used to have. But also we have, of course, identified some weaknesses, especially in our case, small payload, so, and short flying time. But this was, for this particular presentation, the data we took from 2016, 2018, yeah? And nowadays you have the technology is advancing very quickly. So you have new drones that are flying time much longer now, and you can also have a higher payload. So I think it's no more too much an issue. In our case also, we use only normal camera. So for remote sensing specialists, they will find this weakness to have low spectral resolution and poor radiometric performance. But again, nowadays, the technology is advancing very fast, and now you can have sensor like multi-spectral sensor, like can the same band like you use at Landsat satellite, you can put them also on your drone. So it's what we want to do in the near future. So we will have really a direct comparison between the satellite and the drone capability of using multi-spectral sensor. Of course, these rather small equipment are sensitive to weather, especially to strong winds. So if you have strong winds, sometimes you cannot fly. And also the issue is about repairs and maintenance, especially when you work in remote area. So you will need also maybe some external assistance for repair and maintenance, and also some funding. At the same time, I can say that many of these drones, especially the one we use, are quite easy to fix. If there is an issue, if they crash somewhere, it's happened to us, it's happened to everybody using drone. And usually it's not too complicated to repair if you have a bit of experience. There is also this safety and security issue, of course, that people are discussing from time to time. It will be always in the air, the discussion about safety and, of course, security. Some people question also the relevance for community livelihood development. As it's justified questioning. So what is a drone bringing to livelihood development? Okay, maybe that's not exactly what drones are for. And some people question also the potential social impact. I mentioned this cohesion of the community, but sometimes it can be, it's my own experience, and maybe sometimes it can be a matter of conflict, ethical issues, like accusation of spying, privacy violation, so potential conflict as well. That's a potential weakness. For instance, in this environment, something that is often used, especially by NGOs, that's environmental auditing. So in this example on the left, some NGO in Indonesia were looking at this illegal mining that's really destroyed the environment. But in that case, of course, they get immediately in conflict with the company. And in some area, I can say, for instance, that drone has been shot by the company security. And so you can have, for this kind of environmental auditing, you can have a big issue of conflict between the company and the communities. On the right, it's something that we did that it was successful. On the right, that's also a monitoring of an RSPO oil palm company. You know, they should, to get certified, they should keep a piece of forest. And this piece of forest here, you can see that's belongs to community. So community were able to monitor using drone regularly that the company is not encroaching on their on the forest they want to keep. So in that case, it's successful.
Dr. Lomonier?
Yep, I almost finished.
Okay, are we coming? I just wanted to remind you that you have another 3 minutes to.
Okay, that's fine, perfect. Okay. So the challenge I can still put here is as a reminder for the discussion later is, again, it's about privacy, regulation, safety, security. And based on our own experience, in the future, it will be how to better integrate such a collaborative work between, let's say, academia, community, and NGOs with exactly that, with the private sector, and all together with support of the government, for instance, the government spatial planning bureau of Indonesia, course, they are interested in drone as well. So how to collaborative work together on this aspect is something that we still have to look better in the future. And also about the training, the formation of such program. For instance, in Indonesia, you have some NGOs who do a lot of training. It's possible for everybody to attend this training using drone for nature management, for landscape management, for conservation, and so on. But also the government is organizing some training for its own, let's say, Ministry of Forestry staff, and so on. So again, maybe in the future, it's something that we have to look a bit more in detail to see if it's, there is a kind of a general standard or something like that. And also about job, what is this new situation creating in Indonesia? I think, as I mentioned, you have a lot of new NGOs doing usually GIS, remote sensing. They are now involved in this business also of producing map together or for the communities, and I think there is a big business in the air to make sure that communities are not left over. I have colleagues in South America that just managed to give drone to the community. We have not done this yet in Indonesia. So as a conclusion, I think based on my experience here, also some degree of external assistance and funding were still needed, let's say, at least to pre-process and analyze some data before we bring the photo mosaic to the to the community. Of course, it needs a computer, it needs also special software and so on. So we see some degree of external assistance is needed, but I think drone is really a promising tool in this kind of participatory monitoring, especially to empower the local community and their own capacity to defend their land, to negotiate something with the big players. It's also kind of essential to measure, report, and verify the, for instance, Red Plus activities. But as a final word, I should really remind everybody that at community level, technology still need to be used with caution because ethical issues remain extremely important to assess for organizations introducing UAV to community. So thank you. I think that's finished. And I'm, of course, open to discussion and question. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Yves, for such a wonderful and very informative presentation. You introduced the audience about different kinds of drones and then its uses, how it can be used for land use planning, zoning, and various other applications in terms of forest mapping, wildlife, and other varied uses of drones. I feel that we, looking at the participants list, we do have a lot of people from the development sector who proposes bringing in development projects. And then I feel that your case study at Kalimantan about how you went ahead using drone and then how you came up with the land use maps. I feel that could be replicated very much. In fact, I see one of the participants from Gelifu, who is a planner in the municipal authority in one of the cities in the south, where we have elephants. So that particular city is in the process of expanding its boundaries, the municipal boundaries. I feel that using such kind of technology in terms of land use planning and then going ahead with taking care of wildlife corridors would be very much useful in our scenario. Thank you once again. And with this, I am very much delighted to open this floor for a few further exchanges from the participants. If there are any questions, I would like to request to do it by electronically raising your hands, and then we can read out your questions aloud. Otherwise, if there's none, I have a question posted by one Ngong Gelson in the chat box. So just to read his question, like fire, technology can be a good servant as covered in your presentation, but a bad master. Wildlife criminals and poachers are always ahead of us in using novel technologies. Also, our approaches to using tech can be easily expose and lure them. Example, you used it with villages and communities with potential dangers of reaching out to the poachers there. Then there are mismanagement of technologies and drones. Hobbies among youth disturbing wildlife. What is your thought on this, Dr. Yu?
Yeah, that's a very good point. Of course, every kind of new technology can be used in a good or in a bad way. So I don't have specific advice on this. I think that's why we have to go. We have to embrace this technology more or less. It will be at the same time with the bad guys, but I think we always will try to find a way to be more in advance or to counter their use of the technology and so on. So for instance, in Indonesia, it was not with drone, but I remember for some times we worked with community with at that time with cell phone. They were doing photography of the illegal logging, and it was something rather successful. So I think again that's it's a matter of, let's say, in Indonesia we have not given yet, we don't have program to give a drone to community. But as I mentioned, I remember a very good experience of, I think it was in Colombia, where colleagues from University Bristol in UK also teach the community, the people in the village, to use drone. And it was the community people who will monitor their own field, their own forest. Of course, you can create, at the same time, you can create a lot of conflict. And as you know, if you are facing poacher, maybe your life will be in danger if you try to confront them and so on. So it's unfortunately, it's a big issue. I think we still need to learn as much as we can about this technology to be able to use it the most effective way. And exactly that, you will have, for instance, infrared cameras that can also spot the poacher somewhere. So I think we should not give up. I know it's quite challenging, and that's always the issue of new technology, but we cannot avoid too much this. I think we just have to be conscious about it and to continue to address it when it's happened, so we can find a solution. Like now for rhino in Africa, the last solution was to put a microchip inside the horn of the rhino, so they can trace back the poacher easily, this kind of thing. So there is always kind of between the bad and the good guys, there is always this kind of racing. And I think should not discourage you to try to use in a good way the drone technology.
Thank you, Dr. Yves. I would like to ask you about what is the regulations like in Indonesia? Because out here we have a specific regulation specific to UAVs. So
Yeah, in Indonesia, that's not completely settled yet. So when we started to work with drone about 5 years ago, there were no regulation at all. And then because of this issue of some NGOs wanted to monitor the what they call the bad companies for oil palm or for illegal mining and so on, many conflicts arose about this with some companies shooting at the drone and so on. So like 2 years ago, they make regulation finally about where we can use a drone, where we cannot use it, what is the maximum elevation that we can, and also we have to register. For instance, if we work in a land that is jurisdiction of the Ministry of Forestry, we will have also to get the authorization from the Ministry of Forestry. We get the authorization from the National Park, for instance, if we want to work on National Park. So yeah, but it's not yet completely fixed, and they are still working on developing a more final kind of regulation. For the time being, it's still a bit loose. I mean, if you are in a very remote area, nobody will ask anything if you do if you fly a drone.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Eve. In fact, we, like I was mentioning, with that UAV regulation in place, we do have to register each and every drone that we procure. In fact, get the clearance from the Department of Civil Aviation before we bring in a drone to Bhutan. So that way, I feel that at least in Bhutan, we are in a safe place in terms of drone technology being used. Another question that we have in the chat box, Dr. Yi, it's from Wangara, who is working in the Ministry of Health. He says, health sector in Bhutan is exploring drone for delivery of medicines and samples. In the era of Fab Lab, is it advisable for one to fabricate our own drone for official use as we require beyond line of sight drones, which are very expensive to procure? That is his question.
Yeah, I think, as I mentioned now, before it was an issue, this long distance, except if you have very big drone that at least we cannot afford at academia level. But now, I mentioned briefly this group of colleagues in Malaysia. They do this new drone that can really go very far. For the time being, it's more for mapping. I'm not sure they did it as well for delivery of goods, but I think it should be no problem. But still, it's not very cheap. It's like 8,000 US. But the investment, I think, is really worth, because this kind of, you know, that's a mixture of what we call VTOL, so a mixture of helicopter. So start like an helicopter and after it's flying like a plane. That's really fantastic new way of using drone, because you can really, sometimes for us with a small plane, it's an issue for landing, an issue for also for starting sometimes. It's quite difficult. So to have a combination of both is really, really, and this particular drone that I show on the photo, it can go to 100 kilometers. So it's like, I think that's the future, to have this kind of, not too big, because it's still portable in a big suitcase, but still portable. You can really bring it to the field. And at the same time, as I mentioned also, you have many people very talented in terms of building drones. And so you can, if you buy some spare part in to build your own drone, I think that's also much, much cheaper. And I'm sure you have young people who can really master this kind of building their own drone. So it's one way to really reduce the cost. Yeah. In Indonesia, I had some colleagues from NGO also. They make very, very cheap drone. Their purpose is just to monitor the bad guy, but at least they show that they can make very efficient, small, very cheap drone that can be used as well. The next question is about what drone to conduct the glacier and glacier lake survey.
Yeah. Oh. If you can take that.
Yeah, I think that's the same kind of equipment I would suggest. Yeah, it's like this VTOL kind of drone. But if you don't need a too big area, the small copter, like DJI kind of drone, they are very good. Yeah, me, I use very often this because I can bring in my bag. I can go very far with the drone in my bag and then do the. So I don't know how big is the lake, for instance, but I think you can also do that in several times, several days. And so you have a lot of drone, lightweight and powerful, and that you can bring in your bag. Yeah?
Mm-hmm. Another question, can we use drone and artificial intelligence in firefighting? It's one question from Sonam Tunjur, from who's watching us from Facebook Live.
Yeah, I think at least because you know Indonesia is quite famous for the issue of fires. And as far as I remember, there is no drone used for firefighting by itself. The drone is used to monitor the pollution. So we send drone inside the cloud of pollution from the fire to monitor this level of pollution, but not directly to fight. The fire.
Another question, which I feel should be the last question since we are running over time. Now that YouTubers and film industry in Bhutan are moving towards the use of drone technology, do you think it is advisable to allow them to use from the privacy and security perspective?
Well, if you want to develop ecotourism or something like that, I think the movie you do with drone are fantastic, but it's not new. Every television crew has a drone now, and I think it's more a matter of regulation and to make sure that these regulations are taken into account for the people visiting and doing their own. Like myself, if I want to do a kind of commercial movie in Indonesia, I cannot do that without asking a special permit and so on. So I think it's a matter of regulation, but we should not be too much. Yeah, you have always this issue of privacy. I agree when people, because when you do, me, I love flying, so I love aerial photography as well. So there is this enthusiasm, not bad thinking of taking a picture. And sometimes maybe you take a photo of somebody that doesn't want his own yard to be photographed. So we have always to be careful. When I am visiting a village, I always mention this to everybody, and sometimes a farmer will tell me, no, please, me, I don't want. And so it's more a matter again of regulation, and to try to educate people who come with this equipment to visit Bhutan, for instance, to make sure that they follow the rules.
Thank you, Dr. Yves. I feel it's more to do with ethics. Because you are given the permission to make a commercial film, and you shouldn't be infringing on other privacy, others' privacy, by flying your drones over somebody else's private property. With this, we come to the end of the question and answer session. Before we end the session formally, I would like to express my sincere gratitude and my gratefulness to Dr. Lamounier for his insightful and informative presentation and recommendations for artificial intelligence and digital technologies that can help better understand and enhance sustainable strategies and applications for environmental conservation. We are particularly grateful that Dr. Lamounier has tailored his remarks to Bhutan's own distinctive context as a leading country that prioritizes environmental conservation as a key domain of cross-national happiness. We are grateful for your time and for this human and professional connection to you, for our interchange, and for the wonderful new insights that you contributed to this seminar series on the use of artificial intelligence and innovative solutions to support ethical and good governance. May I remind our audience that these seminars will continue over the next few weeks, thanks to the leadership of Dr. Kormaura, the president of the Center for Bhutan and GNH Studies. We will be bringing news of more exciting eminent speakers in the next coming weeks. Please do register for this and the following seminars on the links found on the CBS Facebook or the website or via Instagram. Once again, thank you, Dr. Lamounier, for a truly invigorating and inspiring talk. This seminar series has hosted a number of diverse professionals with unique applications on the use of artificial intelligence in their line of work. Today's session in particular was not only extremely informative, but also nourishing for myself. And I am confident that our audience and all the viewers will leave with many takeaways as well. Thank you once again. Thank you, everyone. And Tashidele.